to come. Just how much trouble is Tom Brady in without Gronk? Plus, I'll explain why the 17-3 Lakers, my Lakers, are not the best team in the NBA. And which NFL contender will be left out of this week's Stephen's A-List? Don't worry, I'll tell him where he went wrong. Second hour, First Take, now.
When it's times like this, it's more to lead by example. Talk's cheap, right? We've talked a lot, and we've talked a bunch and gotten ourselves right to where we are. So in a moment like this, I say hell with the talking, and I'm going to do more. I'm going to work harder. And if you're a young guy looking for somebody to figure it out and how to do it, look at me and some of these other guys, because that's exactly what we're doing, is putting our head down, focusing, and doubling down on ourselves.
Jack venting a little bit, Ezekiel Elliott expressing himself to the Fort Worth Star-Telegram, angry we're not where we expected ourselves to be. We got to channel that the right way. Come in like we did today. Go to work and trust the process. Go out there and play better football. You had Stephen A. until you said trust the process. The Cowboys have a significant...
Yeah. What's up, family? How y'all living?
How we doing?
What's going on, man?
Not much, brother.
I mean, you. Couldn't get here, huh? You couldn't get here, huh?
Nah, I couldn't get here.
Couldn't get here. Marcus Spears couldn't get it. So.
A point, but if you and Max send me some of those private jet hours, I can get anywhere you want me to be, Stephen.
Well, I don't know what you're talking about.
I don't know what you're talking about. I'm not scared.
I think you are. Stephen A's deal is he's not allowed to talk about the private jet, I think.
Yeah, exactly.
He has a non-disclosure.
Marcus, the blizzard was real. And I'm glad you're home safe and you're still here.
All I'm saying is, listen, this brother's in the South. There's been a whole bunch of blizzards, torrential rain, hurricanes, thunderstorms, tornadoes. He's worked through all that stuff, but couldn't get here when the Dallas Cowboys lost.
That's all I'm saying.
Let's go.
Let's go.
Enough of it. You look like you got a little food in your beard. I'm just saying.
Oh my goodness. Haymakers today. All right, Stephen, you need to
grow one.
I don't want one.
Yeah, you can.
I don't got that big head. I don't need to be.
I'm looking good the way I was.
Call me when you're 50 plus.
Guys, are we all done like complimenting ourselves?
Let's go.
Okay, cool. Stephen A., who's the X factor for Dallas down the stretch?
I think it's Ezekiel Elliott. I think that, listen, the Dallas Cowboys were built to run the football. Your offensive line, the money that you invested in them, and the money you invested in Ezekiel Elliott, you give him 12 carries on Thanksgiving night. 8 of those carries came in the first quarter for 56 yards. He was averaging 7 yards a carry in the first quarter. And your $50 million guaranteed man, $90 million man overall as a running back, former, as Max would say, the former fourth overall pick in the NFL draft. This is the guy you built your offense around. And you give him 4 carries over the next 3 quarters? If that ain't grounds for Jason Garrett's immediate dismissal, I don't know what is. That might be the dumbest thing that I could have possibly fathomed. It doesn't matter how much Dak Prescott throws the football. It does not matter how great Amari Cooper looks, how great Gallup looks, Jason Witten and his reemergence from retirement and beyond. If you cannot run the football effectively as a Dallas Cowboy, you will not win. You will not win when it really, really counts. And to me, the fact that you didn't even attempt to give Ezekiel Elliott the football tells me all I need to know.
But that's really on coach.
Yeah.
You know, like, when I think of X Factor, the last guy I think of is Ezekiel Elliott.
Yeah.
Because Ezekiel Elliott, there's no X. There's no unknown there. We know what he is. There are better backs, I believe, in football. But if you want to change it to all-around most consistent back, he's going to give you 4.5 yards a carry. He does everything well, pass, protect, like everything. He's just an all-around excellent football player and among the best backs in the NFL. And that's game in and game out, year in and year out. He seems to be in the middle of a Hall of Fame career. I don't think of that as an X factor. I think of Dak Prescott as an X factor. Because what is Dak? Much as I said earlier in the show, like the proof that Kirk Cousins, you know, deserves some blame after a night like last night, or shows he's not ready for primetime. And one of the pieces of evidence I use is, just imagine Kirk Cousins was Russell Wilson. Would you still be saying the Vikings are a tough out, or would you be maybe picking them to win the Super Bowl? It's the same sort of thing with Dak. Like, who is Dak Prescott? That's your X factor. Some weeks, usually against bad teams, he looks like a great quarterback in his prime. And other weeks you go, you can't rely on Dak Prescott to take you there. He needs a whole lot around him. That, to me, is an X factor.
Max, in any other situation, I would agree with you. But in this particular situation, I'm with Stephen A. Zeke is the X factor because they haven't been using him. That's the point. The point is that they've made Zeke an X factor outside of him being the main catalyst for them having success. It is mind-boggling to me about what the Cowboys are doing. And I get it. Dak is leading the league in passing yards. That's not the formula for the Dallas Cowboys to win. So their X factor is Zeke because they need to go back to that. And we can have all of the conversations we want to have about whether Dak should be paid, if he's played well. Yes, by all measures, Dak has played well. But the Cowboys play well when Zeke Elliott is rolling. Mm-hmm. They are better on defense when they're running the football. They're better on offense when they're running the football. It galvanizes the team. It changes the environment around the Dallas Cowboys when they are having success on the ground. My problem long for this season has been that when you get into these games and you have zero wins against winning opponents, not one of those games did Zeke Elliott become the focal point of trying to win them. And that's a big issue for Dallas and where they stand right now.
Hey, big fella, if Bill Belichick were playing the Cowboys in the Super Bowl, don't you think his game plan would be to see, can Dak beat me with his arm? Right? Like
I'm glad you made that point.
Like in the Super Bowl with the Eagles, I'm bringing up Nick Foles today, but yep. Bill Belichick dared Foles to beat him through the air, stop the run, tempt him, you know, to try and throw the ball. And if you can do it, tip your cap. That's what I mean by Dak is the X factor. Someone's going to dare Dak to beat him. Can he do it?
I have agreed with you about Dak Prescott on a lot of occasions. And I've agreed with you mainly about coaching in the NFL. You don't think people go into the Baltimore Ravens game knowing they're going to run the ball? You don't think people go against the San Francisco 49ers and think that they're not going to run the football? We can make Dak whatever we want to make him because he's shown propensity to have success in all of those areas. But what coaching means is that no matter what you're doing to stop me, I'm going to find a way to get my best player involved. Take the Minnesota Vikings, for instance. Take the Carolina Panthers, for instance. You know damn well people going to stack the box to stop Christian McCaffrey and Dalvin Cook. You know what they still do? They still hand
Marcus,
the ball off to them and figure out
quickly.
A way to get them to run game.
Let me get in here quickly because I know we isolated Dak and Zeke, but you just brought up coaching. And Jerry Jones was just on 105.3 at the Fan, and I want to read the quote from him because now he's defending Jason Garrett. It feels like his tune has changed once again. When asked about him, he says he's the guy for the job. He did not say what Garrett has to do to earn an extension, but he did say, in my opinion, Jason Garrett will be coaching in the NFL next year.
In the NFL.
Yeah. Thoughts just not for that. The Cowboys. Just not for the Cowboys. Molly, you make a great point. Listen. We have had this conversation about quarterbacks. Stephen A. Max and Molly, you've been sitting there while we're talking about it. Mm-hmm. You do not wait to pay guys you're sold on. It doesn't happen in the NFL. I just watched you guys have the conversation about the Eagles and was losing my mind about this conversation and all of the excuses for Carson Wentz. The Philadelphia Eagles paid Carson Wentz because they were a sure bet that he was the guy that could get them to where they needed to be. If Jason Garrett was going to continue to be the Cowboys coach after this year, he would have an extension. Jerry has not waited on extending Jason Garrett. Garrett in any other time. This was a proven year. The year is a waste because of the situation that they're in. The fortunate part for the Dallas Cowboys right now, and as much as it hurts me to say this, is that the NFC East sucks. That's the only reason
that they are surviving.
And it's the only reason that Jason Garrett is surviving.
Marcus, let me say this, because I got to get something off my chest, and this has nothing to do with anybody that's on the set right now with us. I joke around because I can't stand Cowboy fans, and we all know that. I despise Cowboy fans, but it's all in fun. It's all in fun. I got a lot of respect and love for Jerry Jones, and I had the pleasure of meeting Stephen Jones. I'm very fond of him as well, and I really, really have a problem with the words that I just heard you say came out of Jerry Jones' mouth. Let me explain why. Jason Garrett is going to be a coach in this league. All right, yeah, that doesn't mean he's going to be a coach with the Cowboys, but you already have somebody promoting him to be somewhere else. Why? Because you like him. See, this is the kind of stuff that black people lose our minds about. Jason Garrett, I want to remind everybody.
Ain't that many head coaching jobs.
Right now, we're looking. There's only 32 head coaching jobs in the National Football League.
He also said he's the guy for the job, if you see it on the ticker.
There's 32 coaching jobs. A year ago, a man that is a Super Bowl champion, that has gone to two Super Bowls, that has been in numerous AFC championship games, that has never had a losing record, was on the clock where people were talking about there needed to be change. We had pundits, we had commentators, we had football aficionados cowardly talking behind his back in private. I'm talking about Mike Tomlin here. And right now, without his quarterback, without his all-world wide receiver, without his all-world running back, with a fourth-string quarterback, the brother's 7-5. We have a guy in Jason Garrett who, even though it's an 83-65 career record, he's had numerous subpar seasons. In 10 years, he's got two playoff victories. And we have a billionaire who is the owner of America's team, the most popular franchise in all of sports, even before firing him, already promoting him for another job in the NFL. Why? Why is Jason Garrett, of all people, entitled to be in line for another head coaching job when he has a prime job and has done nothing with it? Jerry Jones was on it. We are a week removed from sound of Jerry Jones being on camera saying, excuse me, in the world of business, I could come in sixth place, and that's okay. But in this business, you got to finish on top. You got to finish number one. Jason Garrett has never finished number eight, number five, let alone number one. Hasn't even come close. And the billionaire owner of the most popular franchise, arguably in sports, is sitting here before firing him, already promoting him for another
question
job.
For you.
I got a problem with this.
Question for
I got
you,
a
Stephen
problem
a,
with this.
And Marcus, you could weigh in as well. The NBA had an image problem. At least they were conscious of being perceived as a quote-unquote black league. The NFL has not faced the same kind of stuff. And I've always thought partly that's because the two characters you know on every team are the coach and the quarterback, and they were almost always exclusively white. Now we're seeing that change in terms of quarterbacks. The best quarterbacks in the league, top five or whatever, are all African-American. Do you guys believe that makes it more difficult for African-American head coaches to rise because at that point, whether or not owners are consciously aware of it, the two most prominent faces of teams will both be African-American. You see what I mean?
Yeah.
Do you think that actually puts down like negative pressure on African-American candidates?
Okay, let's answer that after the break.
I will answer that after the break.
Perfect. Let's get into commercial break. We'll have much more on Jerry's recent sound, now defending Jason Garrett, saying he's the guy for the job. More First Take after a quick commercial break. Stay right here. Cuando el juego se va duro en los hay que dar metti su più bel sorriso e so tempo di giocare sei così bella, bella. Peroni Italia.
Introducing McDonald's Snickerdoodle McFlurry, here for a limited time. Creamy vanilla soft serve mixed with crunchy Snickerdoodle topping. It's an easy, delicious treat.